So Genesis 22:16. We're talking about the gifts. You know, we had been talking about the gifts being exchanged, and here we go. And then God makes an oath to Abraham after Abraham has offered up his son Isaac, and you know, remember God gave him, promised Abraham the land, promised him a son, promised him being the fruitfulness of the nations, promised him and counting him as a friend. God, Abraham gave Isaac up as an offering. At least symbolically, he was going to do it, but God stopped him. And then now in Genesis 22:16, starting in verse 15, and the angel of the Lord called unto Abram. So God answers and gives an oath to Abraham. And the Lord God called, angel of the Lord called Abraham out of the heaven the second time and said, by myself have I sworn, saith the Lord. For because thou hast done this thing that and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemy. And in thy seed shall all the nations be blessed, or the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. And we got into that vein on Sunday morning about obedience, bringing the blessing. That God, you know, God's grace makes the provision, but obedience to the commands and dictates and even at times demands of the Lord is what releases the blessing into our life. You know, sinners aren't walking around getting the blessing no matter what they do, are they? There has to be an obedience to accept Jesus Christ as Lord in order to enter into the covenant and to get access to it. Things just don't come on you when you walk in disobedience. We talked about that Sunday. And so we have here the Abrahamic covenant, in not ending, but being summed up in this promise. Because Abraham did not withhold his son, God was going to bless him. Because, and remember, it says here, he obeyed, because you obeyed my voice. Now, this is not a covenant of law. This was a covenant of promise. As you go to the New Testament and study, every time we're talking about Abraham, he said that he received the promise not by works, but by faith. Yet God said, because you obeyed my voice, this is what I'm going to do. So the acts of faith still must be in correlation with obedience to the voice of God. You can't separate that. A lot of people try to. They try to separate faith into this hocus-pocus thing where you know, you just, I believe, and that's it. And somehow or another, we got this idea that works mean, that works, in the sense the Bible speaks against works, and really you have to be, and I use this term often, just for explanation, you have to do a thorough exegesis, or you have to give a realistic exegesis to the scripture. Exegesis means to break it down and to study it and to thoroughly dissect and study the things. Okay, that's what that term refers to. And so we have to be good Bible students and give a good exegesis of subject matter instead of looking flippantly or lightly upon certain scriptures, looking for something that will undergird or support a position we've taken. Let me say this. Our positions taken must always be subject to change by scripture that comes contrary to the position we've taken. In other words, a good exegesis views the scriptures that it do or seem to contradict what we're trying to believe or believe. And we have to allow that to do its work in us. And if we just reject that, that's not what that means, and kind of run off, you're not being a good Bible student. Okay? Now, there's a lot of people who don't want to, you know, you know, God never would judge anybody. Well, ask Ananias and Sapphira. Check out Ananias and Sapphira. Hello? You know, well, they don't want to deal with that. Well, the fact of the matter is, it's there. You know that Paul bound someone over to Satan for the destruction of his flesh so his spirit would be saved in the day of the Lord. Now, that was an extreme case, and an extreme, well, in today's society, that was a minor case. I mean, the guy was sleeping with his stepmama. But it was so bad that Paul put him over to the devil to destroy his flesh so that he would be saved in the day of the Lord. In other words, he wouldn't continue going down that path thinking it was okay. Boy, if we had people running around today getting on television saying, we're binding such a one over to Satan for the destruction of his flesh and his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord, they would say, you need to go listen to the grace preacher. It's all about grace. Well, I'm sorry. Paul was a grace preacher. That's what everybody says now. All the people who preach the radical, extreme, unbiblical grace say that Paul was a preacher of grace, and he's the one that bound the guy over. Quite frankly, it was a grace because his spirit was going to be saved in the day of the Lord. It's better to, you know, endure difficulty that causes you. And what was it all for? It was to bring him to repentance. It was to bring him to repentance. Why? So he would not lose his salvation and go to hell. Paul said that his spirit may be saved. And now I've had people, some of the people who do teach the rapture, say, the guy probably wasn't even saved. Boy, that's just making it up as you go. Sound like a politician. Just make it up on the fly and hope somebody believes it. He wasn't even saved. That's not how the Bible talked about it. As a matter of fact, Paul wrote later in 2 Corinthians and said, receive such a one back, lest he be overcome with sorrow. Hello? Are you here? If he wasn't saved and got saved, they would just say, we would rejoice the fact he got saved. Now he said, receive him, and lest he be overcome with much sorrow. Or say, this must have been bad. You know? So anyway. Good exegesis of Scripture. Yeah. See, Paul, faith, I kind of went that way because that's the hot new thing today, you know, is to get your skinny jeans on and have a cool television show and not use Scripture and just get everybody to go, it's all about grace. No, it's not all about grace. It's about faith. It's about love. Whatever they, not everything is grace. It's not just, did you know the Bible only calls the gospel of grace one time? It's called the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's called the gospel of our Lord God. It's called, it's like 11 different things the gospel's called in the New Testament. And only once is it called the gospel of grace. Now, I'm not demeaning grace. Okay? I believe in grace. Thank God for it. It's a vast central theme of the New Testament. But you can't get out of balance. And say that covers everything. Well, you can't do anything. Then you don't have to do anything. And this is where I am back here. Abraham obeyed because you obeyed my voice. So our point here now, I kind of took my little journey and kind of got on my little soapbox and hit that again. And now we're coming back. Faith must have a relationship to obedience. If Abraham is the father of our faith, he believed God was accounting to him for righteousness. Yet God said, because you obeyed my voice, I'm going to do this. Amen. There has to be a relationship between obedience and faith and receiving from God. Now, if we go, as we're talking about the redemption being the new and the better covenant, we are redeemed. We're not atoned for. One of the aspects of our redemption is prosperity. And yet the Word of God says in the book of 2 Corinthians, I believe, chapter 9, we better flip over there. I don't want to misquote the wrong chapter and the people around there are looking for it and can't find it and everybody's befuddled. We don't want to be befuddled. Anybody want to be befuddled? No, we want to be. We want to be. Yep. And we talked about this. The Bible even called, listen, when you study this whole passage of Scripture, it talks about that giving is a grace. Giving and receiving is a grace. But you know what? That grace operated in principles. Nowhere in the here in 2 Corinthians chapters 8, 9, and 10 does it say it's going to get prosperous no matter what you do. Nowhere. Yet I've heard people teach this. And you just look at the finished work of Jesus and God's going to prosper you. You know, it's not my work. Tithing and giving is a work. No, it's not. It's an obedience to the Word of God. And there is, as we said, there is a relationship between faith and obedience. There's that, therefore, there's a relationship between grace, faith, and obedience that you cannot circumvent and subject to your position without doing a thorough exegesis of Scripture. Now here, Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. We'll just start in verse 1. He says, "For touching the ministry to the saints, it is superfluous for me to write to you. For I know the forwardness of your mind, which I will boast of you to them in Macedonia and Achaia, was ready a year ago, and your zeal hath provoked very many. Yet have I sent the brethren, lest our boasting of you should be in vain in this behalf, as I said, you may be ready. Lest haply, if they of Macedonia come with me and find you unprepared, we, saying not ye, should be ashamed in this same confident boasting. Therefore, I thought it necessary to exhort the brethren that they would go before unto you and make up beforehand your bounty," that is, the word bounty meaning blessing in the Greek, "whereof ye had noticed before that the same might be ready as a matter of bounty," blessing, "and not of covetousness." Stop here. He's talking about you committed to give an offering. Hello. Paul is saying you committed a year ago to give an offering, and I sent people to make sure you were doing what you said you'd do. Now, if you listen to some of the people there, they would have said, you know what? You should have had committed. All you should have done is just looked at the finished work of Jesus. He was going to take care of us anyway. We're looking at the finished work of Jesus. Jesus, we don't need your bounty. We don't need your commitment. That's not what Paul said, is it? I said, that's not what he said, is it? No, he said, you made a commitment, and I sent folks ahead just to make sure you're going to keep it. And if they weren't, we're going to have to make it up, because I'm bringing people with me and told them you committed to this. And then he goes on and says here, verse 6, "But this I say," now folks, can I, let me prerequisite this just a little bit before I say it. There are people teaching that no matter what you do, you're going to prosper. That because you're under grace, God's going to prosper you, because it's nothing to do with you, it's what Jesus did for you. And you see, there's enough truth in the fact that it's not you, it's what Jesus did for you, that it can be used to teach people error. Jesus did go ahead of us. Jesus did make a way where there was no way. Jesus made provision where there was no provision. But there is still the action on the part of the believer that are acts of obedience in relationship to what God's word says for us to do that have a weight and a bearing on what happens. There's no way around it. And if people are teaching otherwise, they're teaching error. And a lot of times it's a lot of young whippersnappers who think they know everything about the Bible, and I know I've been there myself. You think you know everything. Hello? Those who have been in the ministry 40 years don't know nothing because you just showed up and you know everything. You know what you know? Enough to get you in trouble. Hello? Dad Hagin said he'd been in the ministry X number of years one time, I mean 15 years or whatever. He started praying, the eyes of his understanding being like, he said after about 30 days, he went to his wife and said, "I don't know what I've been preaching." He said, "It's a wonder the deacons didn't have to come in and take me in out of the rain, because I'm standing out in the rain because I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know what I'm teaching." He said, "I had more revelation the past 30 days than I had," he was just kind of disappointed in himself that he had so little revelation prior to that. You know, you don't know everything. I went to Bible school. I did too. I thought, man, when I came out of Bible school, I thought I was, let's get rid of Dad, the whole world. We're taking over. Now, I really didn't really think about getting rid of Dad. Now, there was a teaching that came out in the late 80s, early 90s called the Joshua Generation, and they were all about getting rid of the old guys because they were taking over. The ringleader of it was homosexual. And that's right. Don't want any prophets around that can judge them. Yeah. Anyway, sorry. So if it's true, if the teaching, this has to do with covenant, because we got a covenant, a new covenant, and it says it, and we'll get to this here, but the new covenant covers prosperity also. But if I have nothing to do with it, then what I'm about to read you is error. If I don't have to do anything except look at the finished work of Jesus, no actions required on my part, then this next few scriptures or error in the Bible, or the teaching is error. And I got news for you, the Bible's not error, so the teaching has to be. Because he says this, "But I say this, I say, he that soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he that soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully, every man according as he purposes in his heart. So let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work." Now, See, if you're going to pull that out of this context and say God makes all grace abound toward me, I'm always having all sufficiency, all good things, to all good works, and not put it in context, you can make it say that you're going to have all the money in the world. He said, and. And. How many took English in school? What does and mean? They go what? Together. They're not separate. He didn't say, he that sows sparingly shall reap sparingly, he that sows bountifully shall reap bountifully, every man is according to his purposes in his own heart, or God's going to make all grace abound towards you, that you always having all things abound. No. It is in relationship to your giving. It is not an or statement. Now, how many remember math or statements? And or statements in math. They were logical statements, and they were true-false. Okay? 2 + 2 = 4, and 5 + 7 = 13. False statement. Why? Because both sides had to be true in order for this whole to be true. But take the word and out, replace it with the word or, and guess what happens to that statement? It becomes true. Because one part was true. So you could take that part that was true and make it true. You remember those? Did anybody ever get confused doing those in school? Oh, yeah. And meant both sides had to be accurate. Or meant, I just need one side to be accurate, and then it's a true statement. And is a conjunction that means that both are dependent upon each other. Mark 11, 22, 23, 24, and 25 and 6. Now Dan Hagin, everybody thinks Brother Hagin wrote Mark 11, 23, 24. No, it says Mark wrote it. Didn't say Brother Hagin wrote it. Okay? And he knows he did write it. He never claimed to write it. But we teach a lot of Mark 11, 22, 23, and 4, it talks about, if you'll say this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea, shall not doubt in your heart, shall believe the things that you say, shall come to pass, you'll have whatsoever you saith. Amen. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, you shall have them. And when you stand praying, forgive. Now let me tell you something. Let me help you out real good here. I don't care how much faith you got. If you won't forgive, you ain't going to get anything. Because it's an and when ye stand praying, forgive. Amen? Why? Because faith works by love, and unforgiveness is walking out of love. So you can't get around that. Amen? Y'all hear you going home? See, and a lot of people, I got a lot of faith. Yeah, but you walk in unforgiveness all the time. It ain't working. And when you stand praying, if you have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. If you don't forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive you your trespasses. People don't like that either. He's going to forgive me no matter what I do. It's amazing Jesus didn't know that. I mean, being the Son of God, apparently has its limitations if you don't know things. I'm being sarcastic about it, by the way. Rhetorical. Rhetorical sarcasm. Okay? Jesus said that you can, have the faith of God. You can speak to the mountain, tell it to go into the sea. If you don't doubt it, you're going to get it. Anything you desire, anything according to the Word of God. You can't have somebody else's wife, But, whatever you desire, when you pray, believe you receive it, and you shall have it. Then it says, and. When you pray, forgive. So that tells me that forgiveness is a part of receiving from God. And you can go, and by the way, Just for information, if you got anything against anybody, you probably ought to forgive them. And when you're praying, it says, and when you stand praying. You know what it says? And when you stand praying, what were you praying? You were praying that you would believe that you receive what things ever you desire. And when you're praying, forgive. So there is a relationship there that Jesus established between believing and receiving and acting in faith and forgiving and walking in love that have to do with you receiving. John goes on and carries it further later when he says, brothers, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God. He also says in the book of 1 John that if our hearts can, he says, and we know that God hears us, we have the petitions we desired of him. You see, if your heart's condemning you, how will your heart condemn you? When you're walking in unforgiveness, when you're walking out of love, your heart will condemn you. God don't have to come down and condemn you. Your own heart will do it. Amen? I know people don't like some of those things, but you know, you can't get around it. It's still true. Now, that coming back, I'm saying that because we're trying to get back over here to this. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 says, if you sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. Now, how is it that what I do has nothing to do with whether I receive or not if God's word says the relationship between my giving and receiving is contingent upon my doing something called sowing? Didn't say laying down and resting and looking at the finished work. I believe in, now he that's entered in faith is entered in rest. Rest from what? From his own abilities or his own labors. But he's still, listen, giving and obedience to God is not a labor of your flesh. It is obedience to a request or a demand of God. That's not a work of the flesh. Obedience to commands or demands of God are not works of the flesh. We've got to get that clear. We have to understand what a work of the flesh is. Hello? We have to understand the difference between a work of the flesh and obedience in the spirit to the things of God. Now, here's a work of the flesh. You probably heard Dad Hagin tell the story on some tapes and stuff. I heard him tell it in person at least once, maybe more than once. But talked about that when he was pastoring, had that prayer line one day and came up, and there's a lady in the line, and he got to her, and she, you know, he was getting ready to pray for her, and she says, now, Lord, you know I'm the best Christian in this church. And she came based on works. See, she came and expected to receive from God because she did more than anybody else for the kingdom in the church. In other words, see, she wasn't coming in faith to what the Lord Jesus Christ had done for her at the cross and carrying her sickness. Her argument was, I'm the best Christian in the church. He laid hands on her, she didn't get anything. Went on down the line, there was a lady there who was one of the families I know one family like that. I can know a family like that. They're in church, out of church, in church, out of church, in church. When they're in church, when they see you, they love you, the greatest thing since peanut butter and sliced bread, and they love the Lord, they just got flesh problems. You know, you get them talking about the Lord, they love the Holy Ghost, they love the Lord, but they got flesh problems. Okay? And this family was like that, and this woman, she's looking, now Lord, she said, I'm casting myself on your mercy, you know, I'm not worthy, you know, because I've done this and I've done that, and she got healed. Well, she didn't come based on her works. Now, here would be a difference in somebody. Lord, I'm the best tither in the church. You've got to prosper me because I tithe more than anybody else in the church. Can I say something about that? Nobody tithes more than anybody. Now, you may give more after the tithe, but the tithe, 10% is 10% is 10%. The tithe is 10%. So it doesn't matter if you're making $1 million. Now, I understand this in the principles of the kingdom. Obviously, churches would love to have a lot of people who make $1 million a year and you're tithing on it. And somebody's making $50 a year and giving their 10%, it gave the same amount as somebody made $1 million a year and gave their 10%. Then the world doesn't count that way, but God does, because 10% is 10%. Now, you may, when you get into the giving, but you come and say, I'm the biggest tither and giver in the church, and you got to do this for my business because I do that. See, now you're basing it on what you do. You're making your argument based on the fact that you're the best one in the church. Now, that's not how we do it. That's based on your works. You're basing it on what you did. But you see, he said here, that if you sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. You sow bountifully, you'll reap bountifully. Every man has his purposes in his heart. What? See, this is where the attitude begins. It's way before you come to the Lord after you've given a lot of money and say, "Now, Lord, you got to prosper me because I gave such and such amount of money to the church." No, before you ever give it. You've purposed in your heart, Lord, I have this money, and I want to bring it to the house of God because I want to bless your kingdom. I love you, and I thank you for all you've done in my life. You know, and I have this excess for the kingdom, and I'm going to bless the kingdom. Now, God says the person that does that has purposed in their heart, and they're going to reap bountifully. You don't have, and honestly, your prayer of faith took place before you ever did the giving. You don't need to come back when you get in trouble financially and go, now, Lord, I gave more than anybody in the church last year, and now you got to take care of me. See, now you're basing it on your actions. See, the purposing took place before you ever put it into the offering. Hello? Now, a lot of preachers. See, we've got to learn. You have to learn, not just the preachers. You have to learn to be spiritually sensitive to the voice of the Spirit. I have no doubts that there have been services where God moved on people and said, go give the preacher money. Don't have doubt it at all. But all of a sudden, everybody makes it a ritual. You know, that happened for a couple of years there. Every time somebody went to a prosperity convention, everybody was getting up at every service and going up and putting money in the preacher's pocket. And everybody was preaching about how it's giving up and putting money in the preacher's pocket and all that stuff was a blessing. And how they had a jet and they had a $25,000 dog and got a 5-car garage and got a $3 million house and all this kind of stuff. Because, you know, you people giving to them, they're giving up. And they're going to get supernatural debt cancellation, yada, 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 yada. What did they do? Took it and made just like the Pharisees. You've made my word of none effect through the traditions of men. God may have given a word to do something, but you can't make it a tradition of man and then milk the people dry and tell everybody how God's meeting your need. And he'll do the same thing for them if they'll give to you in your pocket. See? And then so if people start giving in that as a work, well, I'm going to go up here and give to the preacher and God's going to give me money. No. Every man gets back because of how he purposed in his heart. I think we put more emphasis on giving to get back than we have of purposing to give to build. And God said that he that sows sparingly will reap sparingly, he that sows bountifully will reap bountifully. Every man, according as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, this is beyond the tithe. Amen. See, our covenant, the new covenant, one of the wonderful things about the new covenant is this. It starts with the attitude of the heart. Before any action starts with the attitude of the heart. Amen. One of the reasons that the excessiveness in the grace teaching has gotten to where it is because people are teaching stuff that people are taking and they're given the outward appearance of living in grace when the purpose of their heart is to circumvent the obedience to the things of God and get away with it. Because it doesn't matter because I'm under grace. See, if you approach grace in the manner that, you know, there's no condemnation to me no matter what I do, and you go out and you get drunk, smoke some dope, fornicate and all that kind of stuff, and then come back in, well, it don't matter. You know, I'm not condemned because I'm under grace. And the Bible says, if your heart condemn you not. I guarantee you, if you're born again, your heart's condemning you all three places. And if it's not, there's trouble. Your heart should be condemning you. Your heart should be saying, this is wrong. The Spirit on the inside of you should be going, you're the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Word of God says, if a man joins himself to a harlot, you know, amen? You're one flesh. He that committeth fornication sinneth against the body. Well, it don't matter. It's just my flesh. It matters. I said it matters. No, you're not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. What you do with your body does matter. It's the temple of the Holy Ghost. That went over big. Everybody, woo, glory. Good preaching. Preach, Pastor! The church doesn't, people are always looking for some kind of whatever. And it frustrates me. All the people who come out and preach these excessive loosey-goosey things, and everybody just flocks to it, and then you get people coming and defending, oh, it's because, you know, the church has been so mean. No. Church hasn't been strong enough in the past few decades. Quite frankly. And I don't mean preaching, you know, that you're going to go to hell if you stub your toe and say a bad word. I'm talking about that God's called us to holiness. God's called us to have right, and holiness is not, I grew up Pentecostal holiness, and you know, a lot of our people believe that holiness is what you wore. I mean, it was the burlap dresses and the beehive hairdos and no makeup, and you know, you couldn't wear lipstick, and you couldn't show your elbows, and you couldn't show your ankles and all that stuff, and you know, you couldn't cut your hair. You get them old women with that beehive hairdo, and their hair is yellowed all up in that thing. Lord, have mercy. They get there shaking their head, you know, and the bobby pins flying up, bing, 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 all over the room. Had to wear safety goggles to a Holy Ghost meeting. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And we thought holiness was what you wore. It's not what you wear. Holiness is an attitude of the heart. Amen. It's an attitude of the heart. And if you love God, you're going to want to please God. You're going to want to live in a way that honors God. That's worse. No, it's not. It's a right heart. If you're looking for ways and teachings that will permit you to do anything you want to do and do things that God's Word has said you shouldn't do, and you're looking for ways to be able to do it, then you're not honoring God. And you should have a heart that wants to honor God. If you're born again, you should love the Lord and want to honor Him. Can you say amen? And I haven't gotten to anything else, have I? So here we go. Every man is according as he purposes in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always have an all sufficiency and all things may abound to every good work. But remember, this is in relationship. Paul's actually, you just can't just jump in here and pull these out. Paul's talking to the church at Corinth about an offering they were giving. So God making all grace abound to them was in relationship to a promise, commitment, and an offering, and towards having the right attitude toward giving. You can't pull it out by itself and go build doctrine on it and make it say something that it didn't say. And what it didn't say is, no matter what you do, no matter how much you do or don't give, it doesn't matter. God's going to make all grace abound towards you, and you're always going to have all sufficiency in all things. Actually, he said that if you give sparingly or sow sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly. And I tell you what, if you sow sparingly enough, you may reap sparingly enough that you're going to have a lack of sufficiency. Amen. As it is written, he is dispersed abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness remains forever. Now, he that ministers seed to the... No. He that ministers seed to the guy who lays down and looks at the finished work of Jesus... I know I'm hammering that, but that's a statement that people are going around making. And they're teaching others. And others are buying into it. And they're having big conventions where they all just go in there and talk about how they don't have to do anything. He that ministers seed to the sower. What does sower dictate? Action. That's what I'm looking for. Action is what? Something, a two-letter word, ing. Action is doing. You got to do something. A sower is doing something. He is sowing. A sower sows. Amen. So he says, now he that ministers seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food and multiply what? Your seed what? Your seed what? Your seed what? If it's in the bag in the garage, guess what it's not going to do? Now, I've got grass seed in my garage, and I don't have a front yard lawn in my bag in my garage. It's still seed. You know why it's still seed? It hadn't been sown. And until I sow it, it's not going to produce. Amen? Now, the Word of God says that He gives seed to the sower. Then He gives you bread to eat. What does it say? Both minister, give seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food, and multiply your seed sowing and increases the fruits of your righteousness. Now stop there for a second, think about this. There's a grace here. Because God says, I'll give you bread for your food, but I'm going to multiply your seed sowing. Why does the guy give you bread for your food? So you won't eat your seed. So while you wait for the harvest to come in, so you got to wait for harvest to come in. And I'll tell you what, if I give you seed to sow and you starve to death before you get your harvest in, it does you no good. So you know what I'm going to do? This is a grace of God. I'm going to supply you food to eat while you sow your seed and wait for the harvest. So that's wise. Because then when the harvest comes in, you'll have bread to eat. Amen? And you'll have seed left over. You know, how many know what happens with your crops? You let them seed out. After you've harvested, you let them seed out, and you get the seed. We took a few collard seeds, cabbage collard seeds, or a special seed you can get down in Eastern Carolina, and planted them, and let them seed out, and we got 10,000 seeds out of about 10 stalks. I'm telling you, we got quart bags full, they're tiny seeds, of collard seeds. I say 10,000. I just don't know how many. There's so many in there, there's no way to count them. I ain't going to sit there and count them. There's a truckload of seed in there. And dear Lord, if I planted all them seed and let those seed out, we could start a cabbage collar company selling seed. But they are a pain in the back end to get, except we cheated. We put them in a black plastic bag, hung them upside down, and let them fall out, and then cut a hole in them and just let them drain out. Oh, well. It worked. That's what we call wisdom. So, he ministers seed to the sower, bread for your food, and multiplies your seed, son, and increases the fruits of your righteousness, being enriched in everything to all bountifulness, or liberality, or simplicity, which causes through us thanksgiving to God. For this ministration of this service not only supplieth the want of the saints, but is abundant also by many thanksgivings unto God. This whole thing is about they were going to give to some needs. They had promised to give to some needs, and all this came out of that, and there was a relationship between their giving, their attitude, their giving, and their receiving. The covenant, the new covenant, is a covenant of obedience, believing, receiving, attitude. All that works in play. If you see the grace of God as a get out of jail free card, but if you see it as a way that circumvents obedience, and then see people start talking about obedience is wrong, it's works, it's flesh. I'm sorry. You've misinterpreted the scriptures greatly. Because here, Paul sent people to make sure they were going to do what they said they would do. And you know what he didn't say in all this? He did not say, hey, it doesn't matter if you don't have it. God's grace is going to supply it. That is not what he said. He said, we're going to make it up before we get there so you won't be ashamed. We're going to figure out a way to get it taken care of before we show up. And I'm going to send some people in there. They're going to make sure you're doing what you said you're going to do. And if not, we're going to turn you upside down and shake your pockets. We're going to get it. No, he didn't say that. But we're going to make it up somehow before everybody gets here so you won't be ashamed and put to shame for your lack of doing what you said you were going to do. And then he went on and started talking about how the relationship between what you did and what you get was there and how much and how little. So we're in a new and a better covenant, but that covenant, now, under the old covenant, people got atoned for. They brought the animals and got covered. And you know what I'm saying? They just showed up with the animal. They didn't have to have a heart change. They didn't have to have an attitude change. It didn't matter what their attitude was when they brought the lamb. As long as the priest took the spotless lamb and covered their sin, they were covered for a year. It didn't matter. Just bring it. Under the new covenant, it's all about the purpose of the heart. And so if you come to God and say, hey, I'm the biggest giver, you're coming based on what you did. if you say, Lord, I want to bless the kingdom, and you give, he said he's going to do certain things. We have to be careful. We got to navigate that line properly. Because you don't want to get to the point where, well, if I've already given, I can't ever say, no, Lord, you know how I purposed in my heart to do such and such, such and such, and I did do that, and now here I am, and I'm in need, and, I've had the opportunity to bless your kingdom, and I thank you that you said, because I did that, you would cause me to reap bountifully. But you know my heart. Before I ever gave, I purposed to give it because I love you. Now, the other guy comes and says, hey, look, I gave $65,000 a year last year. That's a 100-fold return I expect. You know, calculator out. Now you base it on your works. Amen? You're tallying up which part of the French Riviera you could buy a house on based on because of what you did last year at church. It boils down to the heart, the attitude of the heart. Amen? All right, we got to pick up with the covenants with Noah, Abimelech, Jacob and Laban, Joshua and the Gibeonites, and David and Jonathan before we get to Jesus. Hallelujah. So.